Welcome to the fourth video in our Dyslexia series, Structured Literacy in Dyslexia. This video series was developed through a partnership between the Georgia Department of Education and the Mary Frances Early College of Education at the University of Georgia. In this video, we will explore what is meant by a structured literacy approach to reading instruction and what this means for students with dyslexia. As we have reviewed in prior videos, students with dyslexia experience difficulty with word-level reading. These students have difficulty attending to the small units or parts of words. But what does instruction in small units look like? Effective instruction can look different across different decoding programs or approaches, but they will share certain elements. Specifically, effective instruction will be structured in such a way as to scaffold student learning. Teachers will move from teaching simple to more complex skills over the course of instruction. Structured literacy is an umbrella term that refers to approaches to reading that reflect key instructional features, as well as content elements that have been associated with gains in reading development. Instructional features refer to how a teacher is presenting information, while content elements refer to what a teacher is teaching. We will start by examining the elements of how a teacher presents information. Three core principles guide the delivery of structured literacy approaches. The delivery of structured literacy is explicit, systematic, and cumulative. The principle of explicit instruction guides how information is introduced and how errors are addressed. One way to conceptualize explicit instruction is to think about a sports coach. The coach explains and demonstrates a skill, such as teaching proper foot placement for kicking a ball. Then, the coach guides the athlete in practicing this skill while giving specific feedback. Finally, the athlete will apply that skill in a more complex environment like a scrimmage. Explicit instruction in reading works the same way as it does on the soccer field. Within explicit instruction, a teacher directly teaches the sub-skills associated with reading. For example, a teacher would begin by teaching the letter sounds for S, T, P, O, and A. The teacher would then teach students how to blend those sounds together to read words. S, A, T, SAT. In addition, teachers will directly show students how changing a letter changes the word. SAT becomes SAP, SAP becomes TAP, and so forth. Finally, a student would practice applying this skill while reading a book that features these phonics patterns. In contrast, there are approaches to reading that are not explicit. Some approaches to reading are based upon the assumption that through repeated exposure to words, students will either memorize whole words by sight or intuitively pick up on word patterns. Two types of books reflect an implicit approach to reading development: predictable and leveled books. Many of us fondly remember Brown Bear, What Do You See? And the delightful experience when a new animal would appear. This is an example of a predictable book. With predictable texts, readers predict the next word that will appear, in some cases without even seeing the word. Knowing a word without even looking at the printed word is not reading. For preschool children, predictable books are great for oral language development and can help young children learn concepts of print, such as the fact that print conveys a message that is decoded by the skilled reader, and directionality as the reader moves from front to back and left to right when reading. These books do not, though, build word-level reading skills as they do not direct students' attention to the alphabetic principle. School-age students may also experience instruction that is not explicit. In these classrooms, students are assigned leveled books. Parents and many teachers may assume that a book at a student's just right level will include words that the student can read, but this is not how leveled books work. Leveled books are determined by things like the number of sentences in a book, length of sentences, and the number of syllables. Therefore, lower leveled books will be shorter and have fewer sentences. But what is not controlled for with leveled books are the phonics patterns included. Here is an example of a first grade leveled book. Coyotes are wild dogs. Coyotes are mammals. Coyotes have a pointy face and pointy ears. Coyotes are mammals. Coyotes howl loudly. Coyotes are mammals. Are the sentences short? Yes. Is the book brief? Yes. Does the passage contain only 1 to 3 syllable words? Yes. But a first grader attempting to read this book will run into quite a few phonics patterns, including aisled, oi, long A written with magic E, R-controlled ear, owl spelled 2 different ways, O-W and O-U. Further, the repetition of the sentence, "Coyotes are mammals," will likely be memorized by a student after a couple of pages. Unfortunately, research has shown that this type of memorization will not lead to word recognition in other contexts. Ironically, the phonics instruction accompanying this story directed students to identify pictures that begin with the letter C and write a capital and lowercase C under the pictures. The gap between this preschool or early kindergarten phonics skill and the reading demands of the passage is evident. This brings us to the next feature of a structured literacy approach. Instruction is systematic. With systematic instruction, skills are sequenced logically. For example, as students build confidence and fluency with basic phonics concepts, more complex phonics patterns are introduced, such as consonant and vowel digraphs, two letters that make one sound, and spelling patterns like magic E. Returning to our soccer analogy, after the teacher has taught the phonics pattern and provided direct practice applying the skill to the reading of words in isolation, students will engage with a scrimmage, which is reading connected text. Of course, as it is on the soccer field, feedback and reteaching can and does occur during passage reading. In contrast, within guided reading, an approach to reading that makes use of leveled books, a teacher may preview the book with students and introduce a new word such as the word coyote, but phonics skills are not directly taught. Instead, as students encounter unknown words, they are taught to use cues to figure out what the word is. A cue may be looking at a picture to guess the word or looking at the first letter to guess the word. As you can see, this cue is not guiding students to examine all of the letters or letter patterns within a word. Which brings us to the final element of the delivery of structured literacy, cumulative instruction. Cumulative instruction means not only that teachers will move from simple to more complex, but that ongoing review of previously learned skills will be integrated within students' practice. Cumulative instruction with ongoing review will look like many different things within a structured literacy approach, such as reading passages that contain newly introduced phonics skills as well as previously taught skills, fluency work involving previously taught skills, and comparisons between new information and known information to strengthen concept development. In summary, a structured approach to reading is explicit, systematic, and cumulative. But what is the content of a structured literacy approach? To understand what should be taught, we will compare the content of a structured approach to reading instruction with instruction commonly seen in classrooms where teachers are not systematically teaching the code. We begin by looking at what happens in a non-code-based classroom. Here, early reading instruction will focus primarily on what is commonly referred to as sight word instruction. Beginning in kindergarten, students will be assigned a list of whole words to memorize. Here is an example of whole words a kindergartner may be assigned. Every week or so, students will be quizzed to see if they successfully memorize the words. Unfortunately, there are many problems with this practice. To understand those problems, we will go back to a concept introduced in the video on reading development, the concept of orthographic mapping. Orthographic mapping is the process by which written units, spoken units, and meaning are bonded together, resulting in the automatic recognition of a word. Remember, adults automatically recognize 30,000 to 60,000 words. They did not acquire this impressive sight word vocabulary by memorizing whole words. Instead, orthographic mapping occurred because of attention to the individual letters and letter patterns in a word. Which brings us to the first problem with the practice known as sight word instruction. Students are being taught that reading is the memorization of whole words. This practice reflects a long discredited approach to reading called the look-say method, which was popular in the early 1900s. Research has consistently demonstrated that the most efficient and effective path to automatic word recognition is through orthographic mapping, which requires attention to letters, not whole words. The second problem of sight word instruction comes from the types of words included in the sight word lists. The words reflect phonetically regular and irregular words. In a phonetically regular word like bat, each letter represents its most common sound. B for B, A for A, and T for T. With phonetically regular words, students can apply their letter sound knowledge to sound out words. On the other hand, Irregular words do not follow predictable or taught letter sound patterns. Let's return to that kindergarten list of words. We can sort these words into words that can be decoded by understanding basic phonics concepts and those that cannot. Now, let's highlight the words a kindergartner would be able to sound out by applying basic phonics skills. There is no reason why these words should be memorized as whole words. Instead, students should be taught how to decode them. We will return to the phonetically irregular words or words that include phonics patterns that have not been taught later. For now, the point is that through sight word instruction, teachers are using the look-same method to teach words that can be taught through decoding. This brings us to the final problem of sight word practice. Assigning students lists of words to memorize signals to students that they should know all words by sight. This leads to the bad habit of guessing words. Students learn to avoid the more laborious process of decoding, sounding out words, and use whatever cues are available, such as pictures on the page or the first letter of a word, or they simply say a word that makes sense to guess what the unknown word is. In contrast, within a structured approach to literacy, instruction will begin by teaching a small set of letters and their most common sounds. As we discussed in the section on explicit teaching, students will be taught how to blend sounds to read words. Over time, different phonics patterns will be introduced. There are many advantages to a code-based approach. First and foremost, this process is the most efficient way to facilitate orthographic mapping. And second, by teaching a handful of letter sound correspondences or basic phonics patterns, students can apply this knowledge to decode many novel words. In contrast, memorizing whole words is inefficient and limiting. Students can only memorize 300 to 500 words per year. A final advantage of a structured, code-based approach to reading is that this decoding instruction is paired with spelling instruction, which enhances both processes. During decoding instruction, teachers begin with the simplest phonics patterns such as consonant-vowel-consonant words and move to more complex patterns, such as adding a silent or magic E for long vowel sounds. For example, a student who knows the magic E rule sees the word cake and blends the sounds k, a, k together to produce the word. We call this decoding because the reader converted the writing code C-A-K-E to speech sounds. The inverse of decoding is encoding. During encoding, the writer converts the sounds k, a, k to letters. Here, the writer needs knowledge of the code to encode. For the word cake, knowledge of when to use C's and K's and magic E reflect the code-based knowledge needed for encoding. A teacher will integrate decoding and encoding elements during early reading instruction by having students read passages that contain taught phonics patterns, known as decodable texts, and have students spell words that reflect those taught phonics patterns. Further, the principle of cumulative instruction means that skills are revisited and reviewed regularly to build accuracy and automaticity. Therefore, the reading and spelling activities will also include previously taught patterns and words. Which brings us back to those phonetically irregular words from the kindergarten list. What is a teacher supposed to do with these words? Luckily, decoding and encoding can still be used to aid in learning these rule-breaking words. A strategic method developed by really great reading is called heart word magic. Using this method, teachers emphasize spelling to sound relationships. Teachers point out the phonetically regular parts of the word and directly teach the irregular parts, the parts that need to be learned by heart, through direct teaching of the unique spelling. This method facilitates orthographic mapping by drawing readers' attention to the spelling-sound relationships. We now know that effective reading instruction will include direct teaching of decoding and spelling, including phonetically regular and irregular words. But as we know from the simple view of reading, there is much more to reading than word recognition. Students need to know what the words and sentences mean. As difficulty with language is one risk factor for dyslexia, and limited early exposure to a language-rich environment can enhance risk, directly teaching students vocabulary can aid in the development of skilled reading. However, words in isolation do not always build conceptual understanding, which is why engagement with a variety of texts is also essential for developing students' understanding of language, building background knowledge, and knowledge of language structure such as syntax. Like decoding and spelling instruction, a structured approach to language development is systematic and sequential. Rather than haphazardly addressing word meanings as unknown words appear within text, High-utility vocabulary words will be identified, directly taught, and regularly revisited. Likewise, direct attention to morphology will also be included. Beginning in kindergarten, students can learn how word meanings change with the addition of a prefix like un or a suffix like es. Just as decodable texts are an important aspect of decoding and spelling instruction, more complex texts are needed to promote student understanding of language structure. Therefore, classroom instruction and libraries will also include language-rich books, books that delight the ear, mind, and eye. The final piece of the larger literacy puzzle is writing. Writing and comprehension share a similarly reciprocal relationship as reading and spelling. Work in one area improves the other. Again, we can find differences between structured approaches to writing and writing instruction that relies heavily on students figuring out what sounds right. A common, less structured approach to writing is the writing workshop model. In this model, the teacher will spend time at the beginning of class explaining a concept, such as how to write a story based upon a small event, followed by an extended period of independent writing time. During independent writing time, teachers may conference one-to-one with students about their writing, but the focus of the approach is to provide students with extended periods of independent writing time. In contrast, a structured approach to writing will provide direct teaching of the skills associated with writing development. The skills related to writing include handwriting, spelling, and mechanics, as well as the skills needed to generate and organize ideas, plan, and revise writing. Within a structured approach to writing, explicit instruction in basic writing skills is provided. Researchers have found that gains in spelling and handwriting can lead to improvements in writing quantity and quality. Finally, when teachers connect writing across content areas and writing genres, comprehension and background knowledge are strengthened. Reading is a complex task consisting of overlapping and interdependent skills. Effective reading instruction capitalizes on these relationships while explicitly, systematically, and cumulatively teaching the sub-skills associated with the larger domains of skilled reading. If the majority of students appear to benefit from a structured approach to reading, what does this mean for students with dyslexia? As we reviewed in the video on reading development, the skills required for reading are the same for all students. But some students will pick up on the skills quickly. Many will benefit from systematic, scaffolded attention to the domains of reading, and some, including students with dyslexia, will require more intensive, individualized instruction that is delivered through small group or one-on-one instruction. There are specific features of reading instruction that have been demonstrated as effective for students with dyslexia. Specifically, effective instruction for students with dyslexia is diagnostic and prescriptive. It includes frequent progress monitoring. Students require more time to learn skills and more repetitions of practice to gain proficiency, along with more scaffolds to aid skill acquisition, such as mnemonics to remember spelling rules, physical prompts such as biting an apple to make the short ah sound, or strategies to aid self-regulation. Therefore, the road to reading for students with dyslexia may be a little more winding than it is for some students, but given the appropriate intensity and support, gains in reading, spelling, and writing achievement can be made. Let's review. What are the three features of a structured approach to literacy? Structured literacy is explicit, systematic, and cumulative. Does memorization of sight words facilitate reading development? No. Researchers have found that sight word acquisition is supported by decoding and spelling, not by memorizing whole words. What should early reading instruction look like? Early reading instruction should focus on teaching phonics, moving from simple to more complex. What is the role of decodable texts in reading instruction? As students learn new phonics skills, decodable texts provide an opportunity for them to practice their skills. What is the relationship between decoding and spelling? Like many reading-related skills, decoding and spelling share a reciprocal relation. When teachers pair decoding instruction with spelling instruction, both skills are strengthened. Does a structured approach to literacy only involve the teaching of phonics? No. Reading does not occur in isolation of meaning. Within structured approaches to reading, teachers will directly teach vocabulary and morphology and engage students with complex texts. What are the components of effective writing instruction? Lack of fluency in foundational skills such as handwriting and spelling can limit writing output and expression. Therefore, effective writing instruction will specifically address these skills. In addition, direct teaching of text generation and self-regulation techniques have been shown to enhance writing quality. Do students with dyslexia require instruction that is different? Yes. Effective instruction for students with dyslexia will be diagnostic and prescriptive, include frequent progress monitoring, have sufficient levels of intensity, and reflect strategic scaffolding. Funding for the dyslexia series was provided by the Georgia General Assembly. The content was developed by Dr. Kristen Sieski from the University of Georgia. For more information about dyslexia, be sure to check out the other videos in the series.